I don't know about you, but I actually had a very hard time getting dressed this morning. You know, I woke up, I looked out the window, and it was like a river runs through it. And now look at it. You know, I just didn't know what to wear. So I sat there in front of my closet, looking closet, window, thinking, what am I going to do? And I thought, God, I wish I had a jacket. You know, kind of like this jacket, but not exactly like this jacket. You know, a jacket that looked like a jacket, but that maybe was made of some special fiber that was weather sensitive, and I could put it on, and it would know if it got warm out, that it should be a little more breathable, and then at the end of the day, if it got cold out, it should be a little more insulated, and if it rained, maybe something like magical and water resistant would happen, and I wouldn't get soaked. You know, the kind of jacket that people talk about when they talk about the maybe possible future of that very tantalizing and potentially very large, 19 billion in 4 years, market known as wearables. But how likely really is that? And how much of it's science fiction and how much of it is fact? To help us understand, we have a terrific panel, starting with Stefan Olander from Nike, Amanda Parks from MIT and Manufacturing New York, and Sandra Lopez from Intel. So, guys. Maybe just to begin, if you talk a little bit about what exactly you do at these very exciting companies.
So, Sandra Lopez, Intel created a new organization called the New Devices Group, and specifically what I'm responsible for is really driving the business and market development of bringing fashion and technology together. So all of our efforts in terms of how do we drive a dialogue, how do we really understand two industries that, quite frankly, when I look at them, is kind of oil and water. So lots of discussions, and thank you for having us here to really start to facilitate the conversation between two fascinating dynamic industries.
Yeah, thanks. So yeah, I'm Amanda Parks, and right now I'm the Chief of Technology and Research at Manufacturing New York, which is a new hybrid fashion incubator, full-run production facility, factory, and an R&D space, which we're opening in Sunset Park, Brooklyn. I also teach at the MIT Media Lab and at Columbia, was at the Media Lab for many years doing a PhD there in physical computing. And what I'm trying to do is basically I'm on the research side, looking at, you know, all sorts of innovation in terms of materials and tech, and trying to push the industry forward into new directions.
I'm Stefan Olander. I run a group at Nike called Digital Sport, and As you hear from the name, we're looking at the intersection between what digital technology can do to help athletes get better. And when we say athletes, we also say if you have a body, you're an athlete.
Okay, so just to start, can you please define wearables? Because I feel like it's one of those words that we throw around all the time, but no one actually says what it means, and clearly the meaning is evolving. So maybe, Stefan, do you want to start?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. We actually don't use the term.
What term do you use?
We don't really put it in a bucket and say, hey, let's do something which is a wearable. We talk about it through the lens of what are people doing and how can we use technology in a meaningful way to help them do whatever they're doing better. If that takes the shape of something that goes in your shoe or on your wrist or somewhere else on your body, that's good. I think, so for us, it's less about the category itself and more about what it enables. So I'm probably not the right person to answer what wearables is.
Just let me ask you then, at Nike, is there a specific department that deals with the cross-section of technology and shirts and shorts, or is it everybody?
Yeah, no, that is what digital sport is doing.
So that's what you call wearables. Okay, Amanda.
Yeah, so I'm going to answer it maybe not as how wearables are defined right now, but how I want them to be defined. And that's basically any device that is body-centric and takes into account the kind of nuances of the body in materiality and function in performance. And, you know, this is it's not basically just strapping a gadget to the wrist that doesn't make it a wearable device. So thinking about things that are made with a body perspective first.
Well, I think wearable probably came from the tech industry, and we love categories. And so from our standpoint, you know, wearables really stands for something that you're going to want to wear that happens to have technology. And so, you know, if there's another term that we can get rid of the word wearables, all for that. But, you know, really, you know, agreeing with you is that it's about having, whether it's fabrics, accessories that have technology inside, but adds meaningful value versus having it be gimmicky. And so really focusing on enhancing the value and lives of every person on Earth.
Because it is a very funny term. I mean, theoretically, everything that you put on your body is wearables. So it doesn't necessarily have to have a tech dimension. So it may be worth thinking of, you know, if anyone else has another idea, go ahead and shout it out.
I mean, a lot of times it's referred to also as fashion tech, but then when I say that, people think I'm working on e-commerce websites selling clothes. So it does have a naming problem right now.
Right. Okay, Stefan, let's talk about the fuel band, which has certainly been talked about quite a lot over the last couple days. What exactly happened with that?
Yeah, it's been fascinating.
You have a big smile on your face.
Love my fuel band, got a lot of fuel today. I think it's important to take a step back, you know, because if some of you have been reading up on what's going on, you get a certain picture of what's there. But I think what's fascinating is what we set out to do 4 years ago when we started this group was sort of seeing that we think there's a better way of motivating people. And that's always what Nike's been about. And then we had this notion of giving people something other than the calorie to measure how they're doing and what they're doing. And we call this Nike Fuel. And Nike Fuel was a simple proposition that says we could measure how active you are with this currency that is universal. But we didn't have a delivery mechanism for it, because at the time in the marketplace that wasn't there. So we decided, hey, what if we created something that was on your wrist that just went from red to green, and it could have a simple accelerometer that could show you that? And we called it the Fuel Band. And it was not to set out to create a new category or be dominant tech player in the space. It was purely to find a simple way to motivate people. And we had tremendous successes with it. And I think it created a whole new market and an interest for this thing, because being the brand that we are, and I think having a currency that we had, created this incredible interest in the product. For us, it was never about the product. It was about the experience that the product delivered, which was helping people to be more active and motivate them. Now that there's a plethora of devices coming into this space, everyone is jumping into the pool, which is fantastic. Because what we can do is use Nike Fuel and put them on all these devices, whoever manufactures them, and give people what we do, which is experiences that motivate. So when we did that, we realized that we don't have to go and build everything ourselves. And when we make a course correction to invest our resources around the services, it created this incredible spin, and the sky is falling. And actually, the complete opposite is what's happening. We're more committed to digital than we've ever been. We're committed to motivating people, and the way we do that is mainly through partnerships that can scale. So
like with Apple? Like what's happening with Apple?
Well, we have a great relationship with Apple, and it's been going on for 8 years, and they've been a tremendous partner. And I was just saying earlier today, it's fascinating, we actually did our first product that we launched, Nike Plus Running, was a little sensor that went into your shoe that pretty much does the same thing that most of the wearables are doing today. It's got a radio, some processing power, and it's got an accelerometer. And you know, it's just that the way we leveraged that was different than now. And that partnership continues. We love working with them. They're incredibly competent.
I think what Stefan says in terms of partnership is really key, because I think, you know, people say, well, who's going to win the wearable race? And quite frankly, you know, we use this analogy of it's, you know, a horse race, and they're all out of the gate. You have favorites and long shots, and who's going to win? And I think the magic is really going to happen when you actually have a partner that understands manufacturing scale, the technology, married with a brand that really understands lifestyle or really appreciates design and understands the consumer. And when you bring those two together, I think we're going to start to see really valuable wearables that consumers are actually going to want to buy and wear.
Okay, now you've recently announced a collaboration with Humberto Leon and Carol Lim of Opening Ceremony to make another bracelet, as I understand it.
Yeah, it's a smart bracelet, and that goes back to, you know, our philosophy in terms of our premise that, you know, technology, we're really good at engineering. We're really good at creating functional value. Where we have the gap, and we acknowledge it, is we're not designers, we're not a fashion house, and we will never pretend to be a fashion house. So we actively started to look at, you know, which designers out there really appreciate technology, which designers out there are really on the forefront, and we thought Opening Ceremony would be a really great marriage between fashion and tech.
But they're doing one project, is that right?
For us, on our standpoint, when we look at Opening Ceremony, it's a long-term strategic partnership. So we hope that you'll see more than just one product out there.
So this is really fascinating and fantastic to hear from someone who's been working sort of behind the scenes in research for about 10 years, trying to kind of understand that we need to be looking at, you know, emerging designers, emerging models, to be able to kind of push forward. And so there's a kind of opportunity there for new designers to take technology into their sort of realm, into their aesthetic, and redefine it in a new way.
Absolutely, and you know, they really understand the consumer audience. I mean, the value that they bring to the table and having the conversations and collaboration between designers and engineers, it's very exciting in terms of starting to understand each other's industry, a completely different language. I mean, we talk about, it goes anywhere from design to business models and margins, and they're radically different. And so having these conversations, I think, is gonna facilitate and really create a market of beautiful, I like to say, you know, first and foremost, it should be a beautiful accessory or a beautiful garment that you want to wear, and it just happens to have a functional value.
Yeah, like, let's talk for a second about garments, about life beyond the bracelet, because I do feel like we're sort of stuck in this bracelet niche. Everyone's like, oh yeah, we're going to make a band, we'll make a bracelet, we'll make, you know, like a little thing, you know, a pin, but what happens next? I mean, is it going to reach the point where, you know, technology is really a part of apparel, and, you know, whether it's a running, you know, shirt or shorts or sneaker or a jacket or, you know, but something that you wear not because it's a cool gadget, but because it's just what you put on that morning.
Yeah, I think it's fascinating, you know, because the technologies are there and everyone's sort of really trying to figure out, now that I have it, what problem does it solve?
So wait a second, when you say the technologies are there, what technologies are there?
So smart fibers, conductive fibers, the ability to create apparel that does things, that senses the body in motion, that can detect your heart rate, your body temperature, that's there. It's somewhat clunky in the way it's getting delivered and conveyed, but the technologies are there. Now, you run into some friction in that some of them are hard to put in a dryer, you know, but the technology is there. I think the big shift is going to happen when the true problem they solve is of significance, and it can't be done with other things that you already have. I think, to your point, you described, you know, when you walked in, like, if true smarts is really creating something for us that makes our lives fundamentally and dramatically better, then people are going to be willing to invest in that. I think the challenge we have is sometimes with technology, the early implementations don't really deliver on the premise that they solve something. They're just a cool gadget, and or they do something that you can already do, but they introduce friction, like the things about being washable. Those things will be solved inevitably, but I think the big question is, for companies like ourselves, we're obsessing over how we take that sensing input and turn it into something meaningful. If that could help you, if that could tell you whether or not you should run slower or faster today, and you couldn't do that with something else, that's incredibly powerful. But if all it's going to do is going to tell you your heart rate, and you can do this exact same thing with a heart rate strap, it doesn't really solve a new problem. I think that becomes the pivot in this, is when the combination of the technology and the experience it enables that fundamentally solves a problem, that's when you have something.
So are there scenarios that you've imagined already that are problems that you're trying to solve?
Absolutely.
And can you tell us about them?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
So I think the key to this is, as you mentioned, really this idea of pushing materials forward and solving the problems around power and energy. Because I used to curate computational couture runway shows at MIT, and it was, you know, there'd be high concept pieces talking about new models of mobility, et cetera. And before the runway show would start, basically all the designers and their models would be gathered around the power strip, charging up the garments, right? And so, you know, you're basically only as mobile as you are to your next outlet. And so the whole notion of, you know, batteries and energy is really fascinating, because actually it's arbitrary that we have batteries in the kinds of cases that we do. We can put them into fibers. There's a lot of amazing research going on there. And so as soon as we have just that ability, that it's completely invisible and transparent, you don't feel that you're wearing a battery. You're just wearing something with a fiber that happens to have alkaline in it. That's a total, it's a mental shift. You don't have a circuit attached to you. The circuit is the fiber.
But don't, I mean, at a certain point, it's really your responsibility as manufacturers to produce these garments. Because if you ask probably most people in the room, you know, like, imagine your future in wearable clothing, what would it be? You know, what problem do you want to solve? Most people will be like, I don't know. You know, what I said, you know, weather or something. Because really what makes a product exciting and attractive is that it gives you something you didn't even know you wanted until you see it. And you think, oh my God, how did I live without that? So, you know.
No, I mean, I think you're hitting a nail on the head. It's like, if you can't either create a behavior, because there are many things that we use today that we think are pretty obvious that we didn't know, and we didn't know what they would do and how they would take a place in our lives, and that those are the problems we're trying to solve. And I think when you come from a world of sports that we are, and you're close to elite athletes who are the most demanding, who have actually, their expectations are very different because they're very specific. They go, if you can shave a hundredth of a second off, I'm going to do anything for that. When you can take that and translate it into something that, cheers, that everyone wants to have, you have a very different, you create a solution that, to your point, people don't know that they needed.
I mean, I actually had an experience like that last summer. So one of my clients, Ringly, I'm wearing this prototype here, which is a Bluetooth notification device, completely invisible. First and foremost, a beautiful ring, real stones, etc. But it can notify me when I'm missing text messages. And as soon as I met the founder...
You should stand up and just do a little walk.
Yeah, exactly. You can see it later. But when I met the founder last summer, I was going to work with her through my consulting company, and she's describing this idea, and I was like, yeah, you know, women leave their purse somewhere else, they keep going back, they're sort of rude, they're pulling out their phone all the time. And I was that night at a party going, God, I need that ring. I was like waiting for someone, and then I was like, I'm in. Like, I'm going to build a circuit, I'm going to solve the problem because I wanted the device. And so, you know, that's the kind of thing, if I didn't know that how was I going to live without it? So
is that prototyped or is that actually going to be on sale?
This is going to pre-orders in June, so look for
it. Yeah,
yeah, I know. And shipping in late summer.
But I think going back to your comment in terms of everybody's focused on the wrist. If you look at technology and the evolution, you know, it started with your desktop, then your laptop. Then, you know, you went to smartphone and then, you know, your tablet. Things are getting progressively smaller. And so I think the natural progression in terms of computing is the wrist and then figuring that out. And I think, you know, when I look at smart fabrics and what we're researching, we think that's a little bit farther out. It's happening. I think there's just a lot in terms of complexity going, obviously, the washing machine. But I think the natural progression is going to be accessories that you wear, and then I think after that they'll be obviously embedded in your body, right? So,
okay. So what's after the wrist?
You know, honestly, I think consumers are going to tell us. I was just looking at it before I joined, came here. A spreadsheet of over 150 different types of wearables that exist in the market, and I think consumers are really going to start to tell us if it's a pendant, eventually maybe it's, you know, smart, it doesn't have to be a wearable, it could be a smart purse. I think there's so many extensions of computing that can apply. And I think as consumers, as products are successful in the market, obviously we had, you know, the Nike Fuel Band, that's why everybody's latching on to the wrist. You'll see further innovation. So at Intel, we say, you know, we want to be in everything. You know, if it computes, we should be in it because that's what our core competency is, and let consumers kind of guide us and tell us in terms of what they want.
Yeah, and I think, you know, what's really fascinating is when you define something as a smart product, the definition of smart can take very different shapes, right? It could be tons of smarts or it could be a conduit to smarts. So, and what I mean by that is at the end of the day, the you know, we are going to have connected products, but the actual computation can happen somewhere else. And we've seen this. And I think we do carry a phone with us, and it's likely that we're going to continue to do that. And that probably will take different shapes. But its ability to really be both the connective layer to other people, as well as where the hard work gets done, then you can offload a lot of what the product needs to do or the wearable needs to do. So in our world, you know, you think about shoes, obviously. We're fortunate enough to sell a lot of shoes. We think there are things we can do, but smarts doesn't always have to mean measuring, doesn't always have to mean that. The connectivity itself will enable opportunities for us to be in the social space and or do other things that are really, really important and powerful if you look at your life. But I don't think that the definition of it always needs to be it's tracking something, because that doesn't always have to be the solve.
Also, I think that we, you know, there's not a lot of discussion going on, at least not in the press, around kind of augmentation of the physical body. So, you know, look at things like what's going on with the prosthetics world, and that's super fascinating. We're actually to a point where, you know, you can cut off your legs and have prosthetics that will make you run faster. And we're at a very strange point ethically. I think, you know, it came up yesterday in the neuroscience panel. You know, we're there. We're to a point where we can control other fake body parts, right? But what are we going to do to kind of potentially alleviate pain, allow us to walk further, all these kinds of things, exoskeleton type ideas that sort of really enhance our physical functionality, isn't sort of coming up as much. I think partly it's because the wearables right now are being driven by technology companies that are good at making devices that are basically computational, but are not sort of structural and physical.
I mean, talking about the physical, one of the things that I find strange, really, as a you know, someone coming from the fashion world, is the fact that there seems to be still such a divide between tech companies making wearables and fashion people thinking that's a cool thing over there. But they're not really talking to each other. I mean, the Intel opening ceremony collaboration aside, you know, and I've really struggled to understand why more designers, you know, kids from Parsons, kids from FIT, kids from St. Martin's haven't been brought in to work on how these things look. Because clearly, you know, if you look at the success of Apple, yes, they're super cool, but they also look amazing. And there's no question that the aesthetics, you know, drove a huge amount of that market share. So, I mean, why did it take you so long?
Well, on the Intel side, you know, we started the conversations last year, and Intel wasn't jumping on the wearable bandwagon. I mean, we've looked at wearables for the past, you know, 3 or 4 years in our labs, and the challenge being in terms of when can you get something that consumers are actually going to want to buy, and so you have to deal with prototypes, the screens, the complexities with batteries, and we finally felt like the entire industry was making progress. And so we started to engage not only opening ceremony, but the Council of Fashion Designers of America with, you know, they have over 400 designers, and we actually conduct salon sessions to bring We bring the technology engineers within Intel and the fashion industry designers, marketers, and you know, business development to drive the conversation. And it goes anywhere from designing, and you know, some designers are like, I didn't become a designer to create wearable technology. And there's other designers that really understand the importance of where technology is going, because fundamentally they're consumer, they're digital natives. Technology is part of their daily life, and how do they incorporate the two? And it's really driving the creative discussion. It's like a creative brief. Who is your consumer? What does your brand stand for? And how do you leverage technology to enhance the brand experience? And so you're starting to see conversations. I mean, Intel's doing it. Obviously, Google's doing it as well, and other tech companies. So I think, from my standpoint, is we're in the infancy. I feel like I use this analogy that we're dating. We don't know if we like each other. Hopefully, we make it to a couple more dates, and eventually, you see a marriage between the two industries with the emergence of new accessories, new clothing, just happens to have technology inside.
Speaking of the CFDA, have any fashion houses tried to poach Intel employees?
That hasn't happened. No. No, I mean, but I think, and I think the reason why is they understand our expertise. And I think the best way forward is a true collaboration between two industries. Intel's really good at engineering. Fashion is really good at design. Excellent job at marketing. Really good understanding of the supply chain. And, you know, we were having a conversation yesterday with a couple of people with regards to where do consumers want to buy these wearables? Is it a Best Buy? Or is it a Barney's? Is it a Nordstrom? I mean, me, from a consumer standpoint, if I'm going to go buy a bracelet or a watch, I'm going to a traditional fashion retailer. I'm not going to Best Buy. But there's obviously room for the Best Buys of the world in terms of things that are very, I would say wearables that are very tech-centric. But if I want to go buy a beautiful accessory, I'm going to go to a traditional retailer.
Also, when we're thinking about kind of what's going to happen in the future, we need to look at the state of education. So, you know, what's going on in fashion schools. And fashion education is still primarily very analog. And, you know, there's obviously a lot of the physical construction and there's amazing craftsmanship that goes with it. And so, you know, I work with a lot of young emerging designers coming out of fashion school, and they don't have that, they don't see it as part of their world. And, you know, they're kind of mystified by 3D printing. They don't, you know, they don't do a lot of kind of work in this space. And so they're not motivating to be able to kind of get there.
So, I mean, do you think that's a real issue, that the school should be paying attention to it?
Yeah, I mean, I think that it's coming, and for us to sort of have, you're talking about this marriage, the tech companies are starting to reach out to the fashion companies, and I think that it's not being sort of motivated in the other way quite as much, and I think because it's, you know, it's a little bit scary, and I think that's one of the things I'm trying to do with my research lab is to kind of make a kind of comfortable place for young designers to sort of see conductive thread, see things like this in action, And just kind of open up their world to it.
I mean, it's actually interesting because it reminds me of when fur fell really out of fashion, when it became really demonized. The sagafers did a lot of outreach in terms of bringing designers to see how their production facilities were handled. And whatever you think about whether it's good or bad to use it, it was a very effective educational tool for them. And I wonder if there should be more kind of give and take between something like FIT and MIT.
Yeah, and it's starting to happen. It's coming.
And going back to schools, I think they're very important. I think, Parsons has been really great in terms of wanting to actively participate in things that Intel has launched. We launched a Make It Wearable Challenge where it really celebrates entrepreneurs, makers in terms of creating wonderful things. And as, Parsons has students in terms of what will you make with the technology that we can give you. So you're starting to see the engagement and the conversations happen. I think the fashion industry understands the importance that technology has played, obviously, in social media. They're starting to understand wearables and what it stands for. And I think if I look back, if I look a year ahead and look back, my standpoint in terms of success is you see a lot more collaboration between tech and the fashion houses. You see a lot more discussions in terms of anything from product design to the business models and definitely showing forward progress.
Yeah, it's just, I think that there's a potential for a blend. I think right now the silos we live in are historic, but if you look at fashion, lifestyle, technology, it's inevitable that if you don't understand the dynamics to be a relevant player in the future, you probably need pieces of all of these, right? But you got to solve the problem from the inside out. It's not as easy as, hey, let me get a designer that understands fashion that puts a surface or a layer on top of something. You really got to start with at the core understanding. And I think as technology gets smaller and smaller, it almost becomes invisible. And then what it empowers is what's really interesting. But for me, I think that's the thing. When we bring in new shoe designers, they really need to understand the athlete. They need to understand the problem they're solving, and then they need to be great at designing on top of that. And I think that's, but we are often asked, so are you becoming a technology company now? And I always answer is no, but we better be a tech-aware company, because if you don't understand the way people live their lives and how they're connecting with each other, regardless if you're a fashion company or anything else, you're gonna struggle.
I mean, for a final question, I wanted to talk or hear what you think about the fact that it seems to me that most of the wearables that we have now really are one model. Like the fuel band is the fuel band. Maybe they're different colors, but it's effectively like you know what it is. And the thing about fashion and what makes it so successful is that it really is about identity and personal politics and choice. And how do you bridge that gap between a product, technology, that is sort of one thing for everybody, and a market that's really about many different things for many different people?
Well, I mean, I think, we're hinting at it. So, for us, it's been fascinating to see. We've added these Metalux collections of the fuel band where the actual lock is made in metal. So we just launched a gold one for Brazil on the fuel band, which we're excited by. But what that does, it creates a different interest with a different audience. And it's hinting more at you don't need to change fundamentally what the product does, but you need to find something that attracts and appeals to someone's fashion sensibility or sense of style. And I think that speaks to what you were talking about. Like, you got to understand the dynamics of what motivates someone emotionally and why I love a product and what that product does. And that it becomes better correlation between understanding what design you're solving for. And I think ultimately that's going to be, it's going to have to be determined by choice. And electronics, by nature, it's harder to create a plethora of them. I think what we do with Nike ID is one solution.
And sorry, this is your first new iteration?
Yeah, so it's coming out this summer in time for the World Cup that we have. There's a new fuel band that comes out in a gold color.
I mean, I guess the issue then is the cycle is dramatically different from the fashion cycle, which turns over not just twice a year now, but 4 to 10 times a year, I would say. And there is this huge gap between how technology can turn over and how style can turn over. Is it bridgeable?
I mean, yeah, I think that what you're getting at is really the idea that we're following the tech model of production, which is make one device that's good for everyone and make 20 million of them is a manufacturing issue. But really the fashion is motivated by make, tons of very different garments and have very different, allow people to have different identities. And so as soon as I think we do get more fashion companies you know, innately involved in not just kind of concept design, that is where we're going to get a plethora of ideas and, you know, not just get off the wrist, but also have them be part of the production process and to start to think about how those industries can merge. And there's going to be growing pains, and, you know, we probably don't need to turn over 10 times a year, but just kind of thinking back through the process and the production models.
How soon do you think that'll happen, that, you know, you will have those two things together?
Well, I mean, I'm setting up a factory right now in New York, and I think one of the biggest things is to think about how do we make it accessible and you know, financially sustainable for brands. And so one of those things is to reshore and to kind of cut out this issue around kind of having to go overseas and the difficulty of the communication and the scaling issue. Can we make less garments at a similar price point domestically?
Well, Intel, our standpoint is, I mean, we enable ecosystems, right? We've done it in PCs and data centers, and so our fundamental philosophy is that we want to build core technologies that any designer can basically source from Intel. So as much as we enable the PC ecosystem, the data center ecosystem, the Internet of Things, we want to do the same thing for the fashion industry and enable hundreds of designers, so you'll actually see thing that is personal for each individual consumer.
And how have they reacted to that? I mean, are they scared of it, or are they excited about it?
They, meaning the designers. You know, honestly, I've seen a range of designers in terms of they want to be in the game now with wearables. They have a very strong point of view, very advanced. And there's some that just want to experiment, which I think is great. And then there's some designers that actually just, they don't want to be bothered. And that's okay. I think at the end of the day, there's room for everybody. You know, the designers that are far advanced have very interesting ideas around their consumer and solving a unique problem or enhancing their life. And I think those products need to start to come out and have other designers kind of see the success.
Okay, last thing. Pick one wearable that's going to come to the market next that is not a wristband. And describe it specifically, please. Stefan.
I can't speculate on that.
That is not good enough.
No, but I think that there is more work to be done on the wrist before it goes somewhere else. I think it's inevitable that what we're seeing here is people are trying to understand the problem, trying to understand all the things you've been talking about, sort of the style aspect of it. And I think, you know, and no one has really cracked that yet. So if I was to guess, I actually think before it moves somewhere else, that's an area, that's real estate, that's really important. I think someone is going to have to crack that.
So you're still about the iWatch?
I can't speculate.
So I think I'm going to choose Ringly because I know I love this product. But really, I think that beyond this, because I can say this, maybe this is already on the market. Two things. One is basically no one's addressed the issue around hearing and audio, and it's very strange how glasses are seen as a fashion accessory and hearing aids are seen as a prosthetic. And so this whole idea of this interstitial space of headphones and augmentation, and no one's touched that yet. And I think that that's a pretty low hanging fruit. I want to say that it's going to be something in fiber, but we're still a little bit further on that.
Sandra?
My take is so much in the media around fashion needs tech, tech needs fashion. I'm going to go with something that looks fashionable in the manifestation, you know, open for the imagination. But I think the reality is something that is beautiful that I want to wear.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.